Hello and welcome to our program today. I am Pastor Kelvin Mohammed from the Apostolic City Church in Coover in Trinidad. We're so glad that you've chosen to join us today. From wherever you're listening from, whatever part of the world, welcome. And as you join, we encourage you to share this link with your friends. Let's give someone else the opportunity to hear the word of the Lord. As a reminder, we are currently live on Facebook and on YouTube. We've posted the link so you can follow us. And we encourage you to share this link with your friends. You can also listen to us today on radio, Sky 99.5 FM, for our program, The Life That Wins. As always, we will post the links online for you. Join us for a very special Zoom prayer time today, and that's at 6 p.m. our time. We will be praying for the good hand of God to bring deliverance to many. In my conversation with many, I found out that people are in need of deliverance. People are in need of the hand of God upon their lives. People are in need of God to untangle them and untwist them and untie them from the works of the enemy. I want to encourage you to join us as we enter this time of prayer. Remember, we are not at the church building today, but someone will be at the building from 9 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. to receive any gifts, any offerings, or anything that you may have for those that are in need. You can call us or text us, and we will make the appropriate arrangements. We will serve communion today in our program, so we encourage you to stay tuned and have your emblems ready. We worship today with the music of my good friend Lynn Garner from Ascension Life Ministries. We glorify the risen Savior. What happened to Jesus happened to me. So why don't you lift your hands and glorify Him? Yes, this is my anthem. This is my testimony. What happened to Jesus happened to me. Christ and Him crucified, and what that means to us. Oh, we bless You today. We give You glory. We thank You for Your goodness, oh God. And I speak Your blessing and Your favor upon our friends today. And as they listen, that eyes see, that ears hear, and that hearts understand. We bless You today, and we thank You for choosing to be with us in the name of Jesus. Today I'm going to go into the Word of God, and I'm going to be speaking from the book of Psalm 110. I'm talking about ruling in the midst of your enemies, ruling with the God of peace. In Psalm 110, verse 1, the Bible tells us, "The Lord said to my Lord, sit thou at my right hand, till I make your enemies your footstool. The Lord shall send the rod of thy strength out of Zion. Rule in the midst of your enemies," He says. The Amplified said, "The Lord will send forth from Zion the scepter of your strength. Rule then in the midst of your foes." We see the story of Esther as she comes before the king to reverse the sentence of death that was issued over her people. In Esther 5, verse 2, "So it was when the king saw Esther standing in the court, that she found favor in his sight. And the king held out to Esther the golden scepter that was in his hand. Then Esther went there and she touched the top of his scepter." Wisdom here. "Esther touched the scepter of the king, and she reversed the sentence of death that was over her people. Haman, remember, had plotted to kill every Jew. Mordecai says to Esther, 'You have come to the kingdom for such a time as this.'" This is the day, my friend, when God will use the weak to conquer the strong, even the strong man, because they know how to approach the king, and they know how to touch the scepter of his authority. Esther comes before the king. She touches the scepter. She reverses the sentence of death. And I speak today a reversal of every sentence of death. I speak a reversal even of that which was spoken over you. I speak a reversal of word curses. I speak a reversal of the sentence of sickness and death over your life. And I declare to you a sentence of life and not death. The Lord will send the rod, the scepter of his strength, out of Zion, the church, out of the people of God. It is out of our mouths that the scepter comes. He will reverse the sentence of death over our lives. Yes, he's causing us to rule in the midst of our enemies. In Matthew 10:16, Jesus catches this thought. He says, I send you as sheep in the midst of wolves. He says, be therefore wise as serpents and harmless as doves. Interesting comparisons here. The context here is that of sheep sent in the midst of wolves. You see, sheep sent in the midst of wolves, it appears as if they are going to be devoured. But the challenge is not to become a wolf in the world of a wolf. The challenge is not to adopt a wolf-like nature, but to remain a sheep, to remain a dove, because the lamb conquers the beast. And so in order to do this, he says, you need the innocence of a dove, and you need the discernment of the serpent. The serpent is wise for his power to discern. The serpent does not have a very large brain. He cannot be credited with a large IQ, but he can stick his tongue out and he can discern the frequency, the temperature around him. He can tell whether he's in the presence of prey or predator. The dove, on the other hand, is harmless because she has no gallbladder. She may secrete bile, but she cannot store bile. It is the inability to carry the pain of your past into the future. Very clearly, we are seeing here that our ability to win in this war depends on our internal environment more than our external circumstances. I want to say that again. Our ability to win in this war depends more on our internal environment rather than external circumstances. In verse 3, there's a remarkable statement in Psalm 110. The people shall be willing in the day of thy power, in the beauty of holiness, from the womb of the morning. Thou hast the dew of thy youth. Incredible statement. In the day of his power, in the day of his visitation, when we know how to come before the king, when we touch the scepter, he renews our youth. And I'm not just talking about physical age, I'm talking about renewing our hope, renewing our expectation, renewing our vision. It is a different level of consciousness altogether. From the womb of the morning, he births a new day. He births new realities in us. I submit to you that God, in the midst of this coronavirus episode, he wants to birth a new day in you. But the new day is not coming from the sky. It's coming out of you. It is the dew of your youth. It's the womb of the morning. He's birthing something that perhaps you've never experienced before. I do a new thing, says the Lord. Shall you not know it? In verse 4, he says, the Lord has sworn and will not repent. Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Now he introduces something very interesting. He begins to talk about the priesthood of Melchizedek. You see, in the context of ruling, we need a different kind of priesthood. We don't need to follow the Levitical Old Covenant priesthood. We need to have a change of priesthood or administration, a new covenant, a new constitution by which we operate in the earth. This is the order of Melchizedek. And to explain further, Hebrews 6:19 tells us we have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. It enters the inner sanctuary behind the curtain where the forerunner, Jesus, our forerunner, has entered on our behalf. He has become a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. In other words, this is speaking about the coming of Jesus, but it's also speaking of a new covenant kind of priesthood of which you and I are part of. This priesthood of Melchizedek brings certainty. This priesthood of Melchizedek goes into the veil, beyond the veil. He goes into the inner sanctuary. It's an anchor for the soul. You not understand that this kind of priesthood secures us and it assures us and it anchors our identity and our consciousness and our mind in Christ. No longer are we questioning who we are or whether God loves us or he doesn't love us, whether he will provide for us or he doesn't provide for us. This is a different kind of priesthood. It's a new way to rule, ruling from one's internal environment. It goes beyond boundaries, go beyond the outer court and the middle court into the Holy of Holies, go where no other priests have gone before. This is Melchizedek, king of Salem and priest of the Most High God. He met Abraham returning from the defeat of the kings and he blessed him, the Bible tells us. And Abraham gave him a tenth of everything. Yes, I will talk a bit about giving because there is a transaction that takes place here. Melchizedek gives him bread and wine. Melchizedek gives him a resource that is spiritual. He gives him something that is intangible, that changes his seen and tangible world. He gives him a son, as it were. And Abraham gives him a tent. Now, I tell you, giving is a key that opens up the door to abundance. Giving is a key that opens up even your inner resources and releases the gifts of God inside of you. It liberates us from greed and even spiritual resistance. First, the Bible tells us this Melchizedek, he was a king of righteousness, also king of Salem, king of peace, without father and mother, without genealogy, without beginning of days or end of life, resembling the Son of God. He remains a priest forever. No doubt this may have been an appearance of Jesus in the Old Testament, a theophany as it were. But this is a spiritual priesthood that is not traced back to Levi or Aaron. This is a priesthood from above, my friends. It is a spiritual priesthood of which you and I are part of today. Behold, I have come to do your will, O God. In Hebrews 10:9, he removes the first. He takes away the first to establish the second. You see what's going on here. God has removed a priesthood that was bound, a priesthood that could only enter beyond the veil once a year. He has removed an old covenant priesthood with his old covenant garments, as it were. And he is establishing a new kind of priesthood because he wants us to rule in the midst of our enemies. That the Bible tells us this, Jesus, he has sanctified us through the offering of his body once for all. That's the difference here, once for all. The old covenant priesthood would have to do that sacrifice again and again, daily, yearly, on Yom Kippur. It was a constant giving of offerings. The priest had nowhere to sit. He had to be standing because his job was not finished. But we know that when Jesus had finished his work, he is now sat down at the right hand of the Father because it is finished. Understand, all of this is in the context of ruling from a new covenant perspective. God is changing the priesthood because he's changing our authority. He's changing the realm from which we rule. You see, the Old Testament priesthood was over. Remember Jesus, when he comes before Caiaphas, and Caiaphas would question him, "Are you the Son of God?" And Caiaphas tears his garment, almost in the presence of blasphemy, that the priest was not allowed to tear his garment. But when he tore his garment, he signified that that priesthood that he represented was over. It's over. Because the new priest, after the order of Melchizedek, was standing in front of him. He has removed the first to establish the second. Romans 13, verse 14 tells us, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Even as the old garment is torn and Jesus has become our new garment, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Make no provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. Revelation 1:6 tells us something about this priesthood of which you and I are part of. He has made us kings and priests unto God. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. You see, we are the kings. We are the priests on the earth. It is not some earthly monarch somewhere in some part of the world. We are priests of the new covenant. We are priests of a new administration of divine order and divine authority in the earth. We have bread and wine in our hands. Yes, we do not have swords in our hand, but we have bread and wine in our hands. The Lord shall send the rod of thy strength out of Zion, rule in the midst of thine enemies. This word midst here is very interesting. The Hebrew word kareb, and it means the bowels, it means the heart, it means the thoughts, it means the pertinence, it means within oneself. Is the idea of the seat and of the emotion and thought, the seat of thought and emotion. It is a faculty of thought and emotion. In other words, God is saying, when you begin to rule, you're going to rule from an internal environment. Remember what I said to you, in this new configuration, who we are on the inside determines the borders of our operation on the outside. That we rule because we are governed by the law of Christ, the law of the Spirit of Christ in Christ Jesus. We are governed by the law of the Spirit of life in Christ on the inside. And therefore, we can administrate correctly on the outside. You see, this word rule here means to rule your inner being. The idea is caught again in Proverbs 4:23, where he says, keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life. And many of us are familiar with this word issue. But this word issue means several things. And one of the things that it means is border. It means going out. It means extremity. It means end. It means the border of your life. In other words, you can determine the borders of your operation, whether it is spiritual or natural, out of your heart. Out of the heart, we determine the borders of our operation. To understand this, we look at Numbers 34, verse 12, where God is talking to Israel and he's defining the borders of the promised land. And the border shall go down to Jordan, and this shall be your land with the coast thereof round about. He defines it from the salt sea and so forth. He's saying to them, this shall be your goings out. This shall be your comings in. This will be your border. In other words, the borders of what you possess in the promised land, in the new covenant, comes from your heart. Not the edge of a spear, but it comes from your heart. Your heart determines the borders of your life. To understand this priesthood of Melchizedek, to understand this aspect of ruling from a new covenant position, I go to Matthew 8:23, where we see Jesus is on a boat. He's going to the other side. He's with his disciples, and a storm arises. I'm sure you know the story. Now, when he got into the boat, his disciples followed him, and suddenly a great tempest arose on the sea, and the boat was covered with waves. Some of us are living in homes that are covered with waves. Some of us are living in marriages that are now swamped and covered with waves. Wave of problem over wave of problem. And he was asleep, and it seems as if the Lord is asleep on your problem. He's asleep in your boat. Then the disciples came and they awoke him and said, Lord, save us. We are perishing. And that's not a bad prayer, because it invokes a dimension of Jesus that we've not seen before. You see, this is the priest after the order of Melchizedek. And he stands up and he says, why are you fearful? Oh, you have little faith. Then he arose and he rebuked the wind and the sea. And there was a great calm. So the men marveled and they said, how can this be that even the winds and the sea obey him? He has gone beyond the borders of our expectation. Out of his own heart, he's issuing commands of peace to the storm, and the storm, the sea, is obeying him. This is a priesthood after the order of Melchizedek. The borders of his ministry go beyond human limitations and human expectations. This is what Levi could not do. It takes a different kind of priest. It takes someone who's ruling from the heart. It takes someone who knows how to come before the king. He has no limitations, apparently. The wind and the waves obey him. This is a different kind of priest. And this priesthood is available for us today. Romans 16, 19, Paul catches this. He says, be wise in what is good, simple in what is evil. And the God of peace, will crush Satan under your feet shortly. Interesting. The God of peace will crush Satan, not under his feet, but your feet. Because the God of peace is ruling in our hearts. Jesus stood from a position of peace and spoke peace into his situation. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with us. The God of peace was for us. Jesus, from a place of peace, in his own spirit, he spoke peace to his circumstances. Peace, be still. This is the priesthood. This is the new priesthood. And I speak as a priest after the order of Melchizedek today. And I say to you, peace. I speak to your home, peace, be still. I speak to your marriage, peace, be still. I speak to that disease, peace, be still. I speak to the storms, peace, be still. In the name of Jesus. Listen to what Isaiah 54 tells us. Saying, O barren, you who have not borne, break forth into singing. Cry aloud. You who have not labored with child, for more are the children of the desolate than the children of the married woman, says the Lord. And then he says, enlarge the place of your tent. Oh, it's time to extend your borders and let them stretch out the curtains of your dwelling. God wants to enlarge the place where you live, and he wants to enlarge the place where you live and the place where you think. Do not spare. Lengthen your cords. Strengthen your stakes. For you shall expand on the right hand, on the left hand. And I prophesy this to you, and your descendants will inherit the nations and make desolate the inhabited cities. Do not fear, he says. Do not fear, for you will not be ashamed, neither be disgraced. For you will not be put to shame. Indeed, he says, I am extending the borders of your operation. This is what ruling means, ruling in the midst of your enemies. We are ruling as a new kind of priest with a new kind of covenant. Isaiah 60 tells us, arise, verse 60, and shine, for thy light is come. The glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. And then he begins to explain, behold, darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people, but the Lord shall arise upon thee, and his glory will be seen upon thee. Interesting that in the midst of the darkness, in the midst of the corona situation, in the midst of perhaps your financial problems, in the midst of the darkness that you are seeing in your own community, in your own life, he said the light, the glory of the Lord will rise upon thee. This is where it's different. I will cause the authority of God to flow out of you and through you in the midst of the darkness. We rule by shining the light. I'm sure you remember the story of Egypt and Goshen, and the plagues are coming upon Egypt. And as the plagues come upon Egypt, one of those plagues is darkness, and the darkness falls upon Egypt. But while the darkness is in Egypt, there is light in Goshen. There's light in Goshen. And I say, let there be light. Let there be light wherever there is darkness in your life. There was no darkness in Goshen. There was darkness in Egypt, but not in Goshen. In going forward, let me say this, our response and our attitude will determine the outcomes that we experience. And I want to encourage you to use and to speak and to shine the light of God. My response to the darkness is not to run from it, but to turn the light on. Our response is important. The earth shall be filled with darkness, And perhaps you're experiencing that darkness today. Perhaps the darkness is dense, but I say to you that the light is greater still. There is no darkness that can withstand the light. There's no darkness that can stand before the light. Darkness, you see, is not a self-sustaining entity. It is just the absence of the light. And Paul tells us, you see, Paul on the ship, he's going to Rome. He's on a ship called Andromitium in Acts 27. And there is a storm again. And there is a storm. We see a different response to the storm. The disciples, when they were in the midst of a storm, they begin to complain. Paul, in the midst of a storm, he begins to speak the word of the Lord. This is a priest after the order of Melchizedek. He brings out bread and wine. And in Acts 27, verse 25, he says to the men, "Keep your courage, men. I have faith in God. It will happen just as it was told me. Nevertheless, the ship will run aground on some island." And when he had thus spoken, he took bread. Yes, we will have communion today. And gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. And when he had broken it, they began to eat. And now he begins to explain in verse 22. He said, "I exhort you, be of good cheer. For there shall be no loss of any man's life among you on this ship. And I prophesy to you as a priest after the order of Melchizedek that there shall be no loss of life. There shall be no loss of life. There shall be no loss of life in your house today. There shall be no loss of life in your home today. I say your children will not die, but they will live. I prophesy nobody is dying here today." And I want you to say that with me. Nobody is dying in this house. Nobody's dying in this marriage. Nobody's dying. There is no death. I prophesy we will live and we will not die. Speak out of the peace of God in your own heart in the name of Jesus. Peace be still. Peace. Peace be still. I speak peace into that situation. You will live and not die in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And so today, as we come to the end of our program, so I bring before you the emblems, and I encourage you to hold your emblem in your hand. Hold your emblem in your hand. And 1 Corinthians 11, Paul says in verse 23, "I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you." The Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, interesting, he was being betrayed, yet he took bread. In the midst of betrayal, he has learned to conquer. He is wise as a serpent and harmless as a dove. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." I want to say to you, regardless of what you're going through, I want you to begin to give thanks today. I want you to give thanks today. I want you to thank God for the life you have. You see, "I don't feel alive or much alive." Thank him for the little life you have. You said, "I don't have everything." Thank him for what you do have. You may not have all the money, but thank him for the little that you do have. Begin to give thanks. Begin to take your place, rule in the midst of your enemies. And the scripture tells us that in the same manner he took the cup, but he blessed, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. This do in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you show the Lord's death till he comes." And I pray today that he will come. I pray that you will experience a coming of the Lord in your life. And so I encourage you right now to take the emblem of the body of Christ in your hands. And I encourage you to say with me, "When Christ died, I died. When he was buried, I was buried. When he arose, I arose. And where he's seated, I am seated." Today I speak today the healing of your body. I speak the healing of your home. I speak the healing of your marriage. I speak the healing of your life. Some people, I speak the healing of your mind, my friends. I prophesy to your mind that you will not go crazy. But I prophesy the spirit of a sound mind to you. In the name of Jesus, eat all of it now. This is my testimony. I take now the emblem of the cup. Declare with me, I am redeemed, not with corruptible things as silver and gold, but with the precious blood of Jesus. I am redeemed. The blood of Jesus has cleansed me. The blood of Jesus has sanctified me once for all. Drink it now. Father, we thank you today for our friends. Thank you for those who joined in. We want to thank all of you today. I'm Pastor Kelvin Muhammad from the Apostolic City Church in Coover. Remember, we're also live on YouTube. And we encourage you to share this link with your friends. You can listen to us today on radio, Sky 99.5 FM at 5:10 p.m. I will post the links. Remember, we're not at the church building today, but someone will be there from 9 a.m. until 12:30 p.m. If you have gifts to drop off, call us. We can make the appropriate arrangements. Join us for a very special Zoom meeting today. My good friend Mark Agbeko is going to be with us. Dustin Noseworthy is going to be with us. We're going to be having a time of prayer and deliverance for the sick and those that are oppressed. I will put this on Facebook. I will indicate if you are interested. Inbox me. I'll send you the respective links. May God bless you today. May he strengthen you. May he cause his face to shine upon you. May you be blessed in your going in and your coming out. I bless you. I declare God's favor on you. I declare God's strength upon you. I say you are blessed and not cursed. I speak God's healing and God's deliverance. I speak to every storm, peace be still. I speak to every situation. The God of peace will crush Satan under your feet shortly. The Lord bless you. We want to thank you for joining us today. God bless you. Look for us again next Sunday. We may be in our church building. We encourage you to look for us and follow us even on Facebook and on YouTube. God bless you. Have a tremendous day.